Hello, hello, and welcome once again to a Beatles program, a weekly show that we call Things We Said Today. I'm Ken Michaels, one of the co-hosts of the show, which focuses on what's going on in the world of the Beatles as far as news-wise is concerned. I'm joined by my co-host who writes for Beatles Examiner and millions and billions of other Examiner columns, and that, of course, is Steve Marinucci. Hi, Steve.
Hi, Ken. Hello, everyone.
On today's show, we're going to be talking about something that I promised we'd talk about probably in our last show. With all the activity that's happened recently with Paul McCartney, one of the things we haven't talked about, even though we commented about his set list on the new tour called his Out There Tour. Since then, I went to see Paul. I was at his show, the second show that he did in Brooklyn, New York at Barclays Center, and that was on June the 10th. So I thought that I'd give my review and we'd both talk about it.
Okay. First of all, should we run down the set list or what do we want to do here? I mean, it was the standard set list, correct?
Yeah, for the most part. You know that there are one or two particular moments in the set list where he might alternate.
Right.
He might take one song out and put a different song in.
Which he did in this case.
Right.
You got to hear Things We Said Today, of all things.
Well, he knew I was in the audience.
He knew you were in the audience, of course. And
I'm
then
just
you
surprised he didn't mention my name, though.
Oh, darn.
And I got to hear I Saw Her Standing There instead of Get Back.
Right. You got to hear all the other good stuff.
Yeah.
And how was it?
I thought it was a fantastic show. I've said that about every show I've ever seen from him, so that there's no change there. And how could you go wrong with a 2.5-hour show from Paul where he's playing songs that, in most cases, everybody knows or should know?
Right.
A very healthy dose of Beatles, even though I've commented here on this show that I think he's doing too much Beatles for my taste anyway. But like I've said, the highlights for me in every tour from him is when he does songs that he's never done live before, or songs that he hasn't done for a long time. And that certainly was the case with this set list. And I must say, one of the fun aspects of going to a show of Paul's or Ringo's, if you can, and it's practically impossible for people like ourselves where, you know, our jobs concerns talking about what's happening today. Mm-hmm. And I would like to, like in the old days, go to a show and not know what to expect. And not know the set list, which is why we did that show before where you sprung it on me.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and my wife was with me, and she did everything she could to not know the set list. And
with she didn't hear that one show that we did then, right?
No. No, she didn't. In fact, the only song she knew that Paul was going to do was 8 Days a Week, because it just happened to be on a newscast, a local newscast here on our news, one of our news stations in New York.
Okay.
And then she said, damn, you know, it's like there's no way you can avoid finding out something about the concert, even if you don't look online. And so, you know, part of the thrill for me is watching her reaction for the new stuff or songs that he hasn't done for a long time. So that's a big thrill for me. And no doubt about it, the big shocker of all the songs was Being for the Benefit of Mr. Kite, which, as far as I'm concerned, I think he felt right at home. He sang it like he was right at home doing that song. And it was very close to the way the Beatles arranged it anyway, and I have a feeling that a lot of the sound effects that were used in the keyboards, you know, all the different effects and the tape loops and everything that were used in that song were probably fed into Wicks's keyboard because it sounded very much like that.
Mm-hmm.
And for people that haven't seen him yet, he did do the song live on Stephen Colbert's show, and that was a real treat. You really got to hear what the song sounded like with him doing it live. In fact, one of the things that I do want to bring up, maybe I should bring it up later, is it was a disappointment for me, and it has been for quite some time, that when I do see Paul live these days, and it's always a stadium show or a very large venue, the sound, maybe it's from where I'm sitting, is very echoey. You know, it's loud, but it's echoey. And sometimes I've had trouble hearing Paul sing because of that. But when you watch him on television on a show like Stephen Colbert, or if you listen to the Bonnaroo Festival, you know, it's fed through a board. So you're going to hear perfect sound quality. And he sounded great on Stephen Colbert's show doing that song.
Right.
For the most part, when I could hear Paul sing, he sounded great. He sounded fine. I'm not going to kid myself into saying he sounds better than he ever has before, because, hey, come on. He's had one of the greatest voices. In fact, some people may say he is the greatest voice in music. But, you know, you can't compare Paul and the Beatle days and the Wings Over America tour, voice-wise, to what he is today.
Right.
His voice has aged, and you expect it to do that. He's 71 now, and you can't expect him to sound as good today as he did back then. But for someone who's 70, he sounds damn good. So, I mean, all you got to do is compare Maybe I'm Amazed from 1976 to the way he sounds now, and there's a huge difference, and you'd know that just from watching him, how he struggles with certain notes. He doesn't hold notes as long as he used to.
Right.
But his voice is still very good compared to other people in his age group.
Yeah, that's definitely true. Let me ask you about a few of the new songs individually.
Okay.
Let's start with 8 days a week.
I loved it. And in fact, I think when we did our show, I was surprised that it was the show opener. It makes a perfect opener. You know, it helps to have a song that everybody knows and everybody can sing along with. And, you know, that great introduction. The Beatles had so many great intros on their records. And it was just, you know, a fun song and a real treat for me to hear Paul sing the lead vocal.
Okay.
You know, because you're used to hearing John sing it. But, you know, it got everybody up and going, you know, for the show. It was a nice treat.
Oh, I'm just going to pull a few out. Not all of them will be new. How about Junior's Farm?
Junior's Farm sounded great. In fact, one of the things I liked about this show, when I could hear everything with this mix, and like I said, it was very echoey, I loved Rusty's lead guitar solo on Junior's Farm. It was very close to what Jimmy McCullough played on the record. So I think he kind of nailed that.
I'm glad he's doing All My Lovin' Again regularly.
Well, on this tour.
That's always been such a great... That's like kind of a trademark song for him.
Uh-huh.
And I'm glad to hear that again. How do you like... although it's been in there a while, how about My Valentine?
I'm really glad that he's doing it, because... If there's any really, outside of being there, being too much Beatles for me, my major gripe in seeing this set list is there's a ton of stuff from the 60s, there's a decent number of songs from the 70s, nothing from the 80s, except for Here Today, nothing from the 90s, nothing from the previous decade, and My Valentine. So you've got, you know, 30 years in there that are not represented at all. So for that reason alone, I'm very happy that he put My Valentine in there to represent something that he's done recently. And he sounded great. And it sounded like a lot of the people in the audience knew the song, which I'm very happy about. Because as soon as he started to introduce the song as a song that he wrote for Nancy, people knew what it was. You know, and it got a good reaction.
How do you feel about The Long and Winding Road still being in there?
Apparently, it's a problem with you.
I'm not the only one who has made comments that it's time to take it out.
No, I love The Long and Winding Road is one of my all-time favorite songs from any artist. It's one of my favorite Beatles songs. It's one of the, you know, if you're going to pick a handful of Beatles songs that he has to do, to me, that's one of them. I'm never tired of hearing that song, but at the same time, having been to, and I'm very fortunate and blessed and spoiled that I've seen every McCartney tour since 76, at this point, it wouldn't disappoint me to have Let It Be taken out or any of the songs that you feel he has to do, because I've seen him do it so many times.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not as if I pick The Long and Winding Road and say that one has to go. You know, you can just as easily say Lady Madonna has to go. You can just as easily say Blackbird has to go.
You can't it's not say like, Yesterday has to go. You cannot.
Well, it's just because it happens to be his most famous song. But
right.
Yeah, I guess it has to be in there. But of those Beatles songs that he's done almost every single tour, you know, they're all so wonderful and mean so much to me. It's not like I would say The Long and Winding Road has to go. I would not pick that one out above all the others.
We've said this before, that it's when you're in a situation like this, it's incredibly hard to make choices of what to take out and what not to, you know, what to put substitute and all that stuff. And you know, when you've got a catalog like Paul McCartney has, I mean, it's just like, it's a terrible choice to make.
Well,
really.
What's a terrible choice?
Well, it's a terrible thing to have to decide which song you're not going to sing. You know,
well,
when you've got so many great songs to sing.
Well, let me just say this, and forgive me if I've said this already, but when you're doing stadium shows or really large venues, obviously your audience is going to be different than when you're doing small venues.
Mm-hmm.
You're catering to a mass audience, and most of those people are there to hear the Beatles stuff and some of the songs that he knows from his solo career.
Oh, absolutely.
And that's just the way that it is when you're catering to a crowd that size. You know, most of those people are not going to complain if he does Hey Jude, Let It Be, The Long and Winding Road, Yesterday, those songs. They're not going to complain about it. And you made a very good point when we talked about this in a previous show, that as far as the two surviving Beatles are concerned, he's the only one that's going to go deep into that catalog. Let's face it. I mean, Ringo, God bless him. I'm so happy that he's out there all the time touring. But at best, he sings maybe a dozen songs in concert.
Right.
Half those songs are solo songs, and the other half are Beatles songs that he sang lead to. You're not going to get a very healthy dose of Beatles at a Ringo concert, you know, overall.
He did try at one point. Was it Love Me Do? Didn't he cover Love Me Do at one point?
Yes, he did.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember. He did it for VH1 Storytellers.
Right.
And he did it on the tour that followed, yes.
Mm-hmm.
He did do that, but it's not like you feel like you've gone to a Beatles concert. Like,
no.
This, when you see Paul now, this is a Beatles tribute show for the most part to me because it's so heavy Beatles.
Right.
And in fact,
a critic I know once called Paul McCartney the best Beatles tribute band there is.
Right. You know, if you look at this set list and you go song per song, and there's
mm-hmm.
something like 35 songs, I think, altogether,
sure.
two-thirds are Beatles.
Right, right.
If it was my taste, it would be two-thirds solo, one-third Beatles.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I would prefer, because I'm familiar with everything that he's put out, and there's so many great songs, so many treasures in the last four decades plus that he's put out that I wish that he would play.
Right.
And there's so many hits that he still hasn't even done live. That a lot of people know that would really work well as live songs. And I see it posted all the time, like on Facebook.
Right.
This past week, somebody posted, I think it was around Paul's birthday, they posted The World Tonight. My first thought was, he should do that one live. Because that's a song that would really work well live. And then the person, my Facebook friend, wrote back to me, you're absolutely right. There's so many songs like that throughout his solo career. I don't understand why he hasn't done Hell on Wheels. I mean, that's such a great rocker. He's never done that live on stage. You know, Uncle Albert with a Little Luck. There's so many songs there from his solo career that he's never done live before, and many of them were hits still to this day. But
I think Uncle Albert would get get people crazy. I mean, like some of the songs that he brought out this year, I think Uncle Albert would get an incredible reaction. I think, as we've seen this year, they are paying a little bit of attention to that. They are connected enough. Brian especially is very connected. Brian Ray is very connected to the internet, and they're listening. They may not do everything that we hope they do, but I mean the fact that they got out there and did Mr. Kite this year, and you know, and some of the others. I mean that was just kind of a definite proof, as we said before, that they're listening. What did you think about things we said today?
It was fine. You know, I've heard him do that before. He did it on the 89-90 tour, and he's
mm-hmm.
done it a few times since. But this time it was just him alone on acoustic, which was nice.
Okay.
So I like that aspect of it. Definitely Your Mother Should Know sounded great. That was a nice surprise right there. I mean, it wasn't a surprise because I knew the song was coming, but just the fact that it gelled together so well on stage. And not only that, but I could tell from the crowd reaction that a lot of the people there didn't know the set list. So when you heard the very beginning of Your Mother Should Know and he's starting to sing the first verse, I'm hearing this, in the audience. So you could tell a lot of people weren't prepared to hear that one. But yeah, that was a nice surprise. All Together Now was a nice surprise. And again, as I said before, part of my excitement in the concert was turning to my wife and seeing her reaction.
Mm.
We have this little thing going on where I kind of squeeze her hand right before I know there's a surprise coming up. So then there's this anticipation, you know. Okay. But I said to her, there's going to be one really big one. And being for the benefit of Mr. Kite is the one that I was referring to. So the look on her face when the song started, that's something I will take with me. But, okay. You know, it's so great to hear him acknowledge all these songs that he's never done live before from the Beatle days. Like I said, I wish there were a lot more of those from his solo career. But, you know, to hear all those songs all together now, I think I said this before, is one of those songs that's a great sing-along song.
Right.
Like Uncle Albert would be. Everybody singing Hands Across the Water. You know, I mean, that would be a great moment there. Like Obladi Oblada is. It's one of those songs where you say to yourself, what took him so long to do a song like that? It's a great crowd pleaser.
I still altogether think this now. Vanderbilt is the biggie. It was just a shock when it got in there, and it worked so well. I can't believe how well that song works. I love seeing that. I love seeing him do that. I know he did it in San Francisco at AT&T when he was there last time, and that was just that was great to see that finally. So that's another great song. What about High, High, High?
High, High, High was the absolute highlight of the show for me, no pun there, but because it's such a great rock song. It's one of those songs which, as I've said, he never should have taken out of his set list. It's a great rocker. It belongs towards the end of the show. As a matter of fact, this just dawned on me. When we were talking about his set list, High, High, High was in the first half of the show. And we were saying, that doesn't belong there. That should be close to the end of the concert. And he moved it.
Yep.
I'm not saying it's because of us. But it's just a song that belongs. You know, it's one of those real up-tempo, great hook, great vocals, everything about it. It's got such an edge to it. It's one of those songs where I love the studio version, but I love the live version just as much, if not even more.
Well, I don't know. Two coincidences there. I mean, he sang things we said today, and he moved High, High, High just the end of the set because you asked him to. I mean,
that's it.
Yeah.
All right, Paul. I want an all-solo show next.
Yeah, okay.
If he does that, then I'll believe you, Steve.
Oh, all right. All right. But it sounds like it was a fun show.
It was a fun show. I loved the fact that he brought back Listen to What the Man Said, which is one of those songs that he should have brought back. You know, the fact that it's 37 years since the Wings Over America tour, and he's never done that song in his tour since then, a number one hit like that. The arrangement was a little bit different. And I know that you've heard this before because he also did the song on Stephen Colbert's show, but the beat that Abe is drumming, it's kind of like a shuffle beat.
Mm-hmm.
Has a little bit of a different feel. But I'm glad that he brought that back into the set list.
What about the stage? Oh, there's been a lot of comments from people about the stage, about the new stage for the tour.
Well, unfortunately, from where I was sitting, I had a very sharp angle, and I couldn't see the front of the stage, and I couldn't see the screen behind the band.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen some of the videos, like for All Together Now, online, on YouTube, but I didn't see it when I was at the concert. So I was looking down at the stage. It was like a 180-degree view that I had, and I was also looking up at the screen. So I really couldn't see all the videos behind the band. I couldn't see the visuals there. So I couldn't really comment about that. What I did see really was mainly Paul on stage on the big screen,
mm-hmm.
looking at the band, seeing whatever shots were on the big screen, seeing mainly a performance from the band instead of everything else around it.
Did the stage, however, move out into the audience, or did it do something?
No. The only thing that I noticed was Live and Let Die. The fireworks were louder than I've ever heard them before.
Mm.
Yeah, I was really startled. I was not expecting that. I like the fact that during the concert he had some things to say, some tributes. I mean, obviously the John and George tributes, but he also said a few nice words about Phil Ramone.
Really?
And dedicated Another Day to him because Phil worked on the song with him.
Oh, right.
He mentioned the fact that the Eastman family was in the audience, acknowledging that and dedicating Maybe I'm Amazed to Linda.
Mm-hmm.
So you had, you know, several tributes going on during the show. And I think he was very personable, even though you know that he says some of the same things from show to show. He brings up some of the same stories, like how Jimi Hendrix played Sgt. Pepper a couple of days after the Beatles album came out.
He's been saying that for about the last three tours.
Right. How the people in Russia love Mrs. Vanderbilt.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things like that. And he could be funny at times. And for people who haven't heard these stories a gazillion times, they're amused by it. So, you know, it's still a great show.
He did ask a question about Brooklyn Girls, I understand.
There was someone in the audience on the floor that had a banner that read, Brooklyn Girls do it 8 days a week or more than 8 days a week. And then he questioned that and everybody laughed. So, yeah, he does that every now and then. He'll acknowledge a sign
right.
in the audience, even though he said that he tries not to.
Yeah. It's become kind of a game, I think, between the fans and him. You know, they try to come up with some interesting signs that, that get his attention, and he tries either to ignore them or not. And sometimes he does, and sometimes he doesn't.
Uh-huh.
A friend of mine had that happen to him in San Francisco, where he actually acknowledged his sign here. So, but yeah, that's I guess that's part of the fun of going to the shows and seeing what's going on.
And I thought Another Day sounded great.
Mm-hmm.
And back in 93 when he did his New World Tour, that was the highlight song for me. And, well, I also think that as much as I commented about the two tributes, the one to John and the one to George, and I wish that Paul would choose something else at this point because he's been doing the same two songs for mm-hmm. 10 years now, I will say that this was the best I ever heard him sing here today. I mean, very often his voice will crack in that song. And I don't know if it's because he's struggling to sing it or because it's a very emotional song for him. But he pretty much held his own singing that song. And there are moments there when there's high notes. And he did very well on here today, that particular performance. It really was the best I ever heard him sing it.
Yeah, that's a very, I guess you could call it kind of a very emotional is really the way to put it. But there's some bare emotion in there, the way he sings it. And so, yeah, you can kind of see that would probably get him. How about we haven't mentioned Lovely Rita yet.
I thought that sounded great, although he did take it down in key.
Did he?
Yeah, not a lot. I think it was just, I think it went from E to D.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's something that Paul never does. I'm pretty sure that when he did Fixing a Hole on the 2005 tour, and it was just him on the piano, I think he took that down one key. But most of the time, he's pretty stubborn, and he sticks to the same key.
Mm-hmm.
Even if there are certain songs where he struggles, like Maybe I'm Amazed, for example. He doesn't bring that down at all. But for
right.
some reason, he brought down Lovely Rita. But it sounded great. I think the song went on a bit longer because it wasn't as tight. It wasn't the same number of measures or bars towards the end, you know, of the Beatles recording. It went on just a little bit longer, which I found kind of interesting. No, his voice sounded really good on that. And at this point, with the exception of When I'm 64, he's done every Paul song, Paul vocal song from Sgt. Pepper live now.
Hmm.
Plus being for the benefit of Mr. Kite. So, and A Day in the Life.
Right.
So, yeah, I'm glad that he did that. You know, like I said, when you've seen Paul, and I believe me, I feel so blessed to have seen him so many times. When he does something that he hasn't done before live, it's so great. And there's so many wonderful songs, whether it's solo, whether it's Beatles, that he's never done live before. That's what I look forward to the most. But at the same time, it's also, and I've noticed this more as I've gotten older, is that I love seeing the crowd reaction. And what I noticed, and I've noticed this at most Paul shows, and it's a blessing to itself, is that you've got the widest range in age. You've got teenagers there. You've got first-generation fans there. You've got McCartney shirts being worn by teenagers and Beatles shirts as well.
Mm-hmm.
And for some of these people, it's the first time ever they've seen Paul,
right.
which is something that we tend to forget. You know, and all over the world, there are millions of people who still to this day have never seen Paul McCartney live.
Right.
Or Ringo, for that matter.
Right.
He either hasn't gone to their area, or he rarely does, or maybe it's too expensive a ticket for people.
Right.
There's so many reasons why people around the world still, to this day, haven't seen Paul or Ringo live. And so to see these people who you know, especially if they're young, they haven't seen him before, to see them enjoy it. At the end of the concert, everybody's smiling. You know, so I could say all that I want to say about I wish there was more solo music, but you can't argue the crowd reaction here. You have to be grateful at this point that he's doing this. And with every passing day, I appreciate it even more because, you know, how much more time will he have to give us this?
That's right.
So, you know, he's spending 2.5 hours, sometimes longer, a night when he could be doing something else. He could be on a yacht right now having fun.
Yeah.
He's got a beautiful wife that he loves. He's got kids that he loves. He's got grandkids. And he's very much a family man. So he's still spending time giving to us. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate the fact that he's doing this. I also remember because I took one of my cousins with me to see the show, and he'd only seen Paul once before this. But the one thing he kept saying to me was, I can't believe he has the stamina to do this.
I know. That's really one of the amazing things about seeing him is, you know, how much energy he puts into that show.
Yeah.
It's like, it's crazy. I was going to mention, talking about songs that he didn't originally sing that he's singing now, reminds me, we're talking about Mr. Kite, obviously, reminds me of when he did Strawberry Fields Forever way back. I think it was, I can't remember exactly when that was, but that was fantastic.
Yeah, that was a medley that he did as a tribute to John with Help, Strawberry Fields, and Give Peace a Chance. And there's an import CD single that came out where you can hear him doing that in Liverpool in 1990.
Right.
And that worked so well.
Yeah, it really did. Actually, that would be great if he would do Strawberry Fields Forever, the whole song. Boy, that would be, I don't know that he would, but it'd be great.
Well, I question why he hasn't. Because there are certain John songs that he has cited over the years as songs that he really loves.
Mm-hmm.
That being one of them. A Day in the Life being another, which obviously he has done now. But, you know, being for the benefit of Mr. Kite was a big surprise for me. Tomorrow Never Knows is one that I really wish he would do because he often brings that one up. And he's very proud of that song, and especially the fact that the whole idea about the backwards tape loops came from Paul.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think that would be a great concert opener.
It would be.
Would shock the hell out of everybody, really.
It sure would.
And I always remember the special that came out, The Love We Make, the concert that he did for 9/11 at Madison Square Garden. And you see a lot of backstage footage, and Will Lee is there.
Right.
From the Fab Four, and he talks about the fact that he's in this band, the Fab Four, a tribute to the Beatles. And the first thing Paul says to him is, do you do Tomorrow Never Knows? No, he didn't say one of his songs, you know. It's like, why pick that one out of a hat, you know? So, you know, he's obviously proud of those songs. And, you know, as much as I wish he wouldn't do so much Beatles, I certainly would love to hear him do more of John's songs or George's songs.
Which, by the way, if anybody has not seen them, I don't know if you've seen them. I've seen Fab Four. They are tremendous.
I've seen them. They're absolutely wonderful.
They are. They are absolutely wonderful. They really are.
But anyway, overall, this was a great show. I mean, you can't argue the fact that he's got so many songs that everybody knows. And as I said before, as much as I wish there was more solo, you can never go wrong with Beatles. You know, the crowd loves it. And maybe it's true, like you said, that between Paul and Ringo, he's the only one that's going to carry that weight, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
I do question, though. And maybe we should pose this to all of our listeners. If John was alive today and he kept on touring, and we know that there were plans for him to tour with Double Fantasy, do you think that he would ever go this heavy on Beatles? You don't know with John, but...
You don't know, but Yoko has said that he had... that they were formulating plans for the tour and that it did include Beatles songs.
Yeah, but you don't know how many. The question is not if he would do it. It's just how deep into the catalog would he go?
Knowing John, I don't think he would go as deep as Paul is doing it.
Yeah, but people change over the years, too.
True.
You just don't know.
Yeah,
John was always changing.
Unfortunately, we don't know. It's one of the sad things about the situation is that we have no idea what John would have done and how things would have changed and all that. I mean, we don't know.
I was actually very surprised when George did as many as he did in Live in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
So, Anyway, but it was an amazing show, and I would highly recommend anyone to go and see it. And like all of his tours, the last several years, they usually get extended. They usually last a couple of years. He just adds legs on to his tours. So if he's playing in your area, by all means, go see it. You know,
and that's presumably what's going to happen. There are rumors that it's going to be extended, actually, in other countries.
Right.
So we shall see, we shall see.
Okay. So we have to wrap things up now, and very quickly, if you want to get in touch with us, you can write to our email address, which is thingswesaidtodayradioshow@gmail.com. You can also check out my website, which is kenmichaelsradio.com, and there's trivia on the website every single week where you can win prizes and lots of interviews with people in the Beatle world. You can also email me directly at everylittlething@att.net. To get in touch with you, Steve, they have to do what?
BeatlesExaminer@gmail.com. You can look me up on examiner.com. I'm presumably all over the place.
You
I'm
are.
On Facebook. I'm on Facebook. The show's on Facebook under Things We Said Today. So I'm very easy to get in touch with. I want to add one thing that we talked about last week with the Ringo exhibit. We were talking like it would tour, and I talked to one of the curators of the exhibit who said it will definitely not be touring. So if you plan to see the exhibit, you need to go to Los Angeles to see it.
I wonder why that is.
I'm thinking it's because so much of the stuff is Ringo's personal stuff. And if it tours, obviously it's separated from him. And I think he basically just made the commitment for the year and that's it. Or whatever, you know, however long it stays in Los Angeles. But I think that's what it is. So.
Okay. Well, by all means, I have every intention of going to see it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I just don't know when. I'll
okay.
let you know, and I'll definitely, you know, let the people listening to this show know.
Okay.
Because I'd like to talk about it on this show with you.
Okay.
So. All right, so for Things We Said Today, I'm Ken Michaels, thanking all of you for listening, and I'll see you next time.
And this is Steve Marinucci, thanking everybody for listening, and we'll see you next time.